Now I would like to call upon the dais, His Lordship, Honorable Mr. Justice Manikumar, to give his keynote address. Thank you.
Respected Honorable Justice Mahapatiya, former Judge Supreme Court of India and Chairperson National Company Law Appellate Tribunal, Honorable Justice Venugopal, former Judge, High Court Madras, and now member, Company Law Tribunal, Honorable Justice Kripakaran, Honorable Justice Jayachandran, Honorable Justice Kuddus, Mr. Prakash Kumar, Judicial Member, National Company Law Tribunal, Chennai, Mr. Vijayanarayanan, then Advocate General Government of Tamil Nadu, Mr. Om Prakash, Senior Advocate, Mr. A.R.R. Sundaresan, Senior Advocate and President of Madras Bar Association, members of the Bar Council of Puducherry in Tamil Nadu, Mr. Subhan Patra, President, Society for Insolvency Practitioners of India, Senior Advocates, Mr. Arvind Pandya, Additional Advocate General, I'm sorry, and just Senior Advocates and my friends, good morning to all. I'm extremely happy to note that the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry has organized a seminar on insolvency and bankruptcy. Emerging trends touching upon the latest legislation, and I'm sure with the resource persons present here who are going to share their views, ideas and experience, the audience will have a better view of the latest legislation and would benefit. Mr. Vijayanarayanan has addressed about the background of the legislation and how SICA and other recovery laws did not specifically address the insolvency resolution and also the delay. I will only add, because I think since I have been asked to address on the keynote address, I just wanted to trace down the history of this particular legislation and few provisions as to how there is a difference in the earlier acts, which did not give the desired result, and why the Government of India had come forward with a consolidated legislation. There are insolvency laws, they were, in fact, I should say, the Provisional Insolvency Act 1920, the Presidency Towns Insolvency Act 1909. These two enactments, morning Mr. Subramanian, welcome. These two enactments did not provide for any restructuring or revival of an insolvent company. There are also provisions in the SIC Industrial Companies Act, 1985. In one of the cases, the Honorable Supreme Court, with the data available in the World Bank, noticed that India stood at 135th position out of 190 countries in the issue of resolving insolvency. The United Nations Commission on International Trade, which is a subsidiary body of the General Assembly of the United Nations, brought in cross-border insolvency and in 1997 created a model law to assist the member states in relation to regulation of corporate insolvency and financial distress. Now coming to the Indian scenario, Government of India started the insolvency resolution process with the constitution of a committee headed by Justice Iradi in 1999 to examine and make recommendations with regard to the desirability of the changes in the existing laws relating to winding up of companies so as to achieve more transparency and to avoid delay in the final liquidation of the companies. See, this is in respect of liquidation. We will come down, there are reports and recommendations which I don't want to read. But this was followed by another committee by Mr. T.K. Viswanathan, former Secretary General, Lok Sabha, former Law Secretary, Union of India, to study corporate bankruptcy legal work in India and to submit a report. Taking note of the reports, the desirability of a constitution of a separate forum divesting the powers from the High Court, because the High Court company matters were heard by a High Court judge, so also the matters relating to insolvency were heard by a High Court judge. The government thought it fit that we must have a separate forum. But how to deal with it there in the High Court? The provisions, existing provisions, you know, there are issues like whether the matters have to be transferred to the tribunal after the constitution of the tribunal. One such matter is pending before us. So the government thought it fit that we must have a two-tier mechanism. One, to have a company law tribunal in the state, and at the national level, a company law appellate tribunal. But when the government accepted this report and enacted what is called as the Company Law, Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, it created new concepts. I will read only a few concepts in fact which are created under the code and also highlight as to what the code brings in. Some of the provisions which have been repealed, acts I should say, repealed are winding up proceedings under the Companies Act, Presidency Term Insolvency Act, Provincial Insolvency Act, Sikh Industrial Companies Act, and there are other enactments, about 10 enactments, in fact various provisions have been struck down, and then consolidating all the provisions, it gave birth to the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code 2016, that is Act 2016. Some of the salient features of this code are, one is consolidation, as I said, number two is multiple bodies and professionals. Some of them are newly inducted that you will not find in any other enactment, only in this bankruptcy code it is created. Multiple bodies, professionals to manage and facilitate the whole insolvency process. You will not find any such process in other enactments, but in this particular code, some new persons have been inducted, new bodies have been created. This is to have a structured and a comprehensive manner. The insolvency resolution process has to be taken up. That's how we have Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India, information utilities to furnish data, insolvency professionals who take up the process of resolution, restructuring so that the company can revive, insolvency professional entities, insolvency professional agencies. Unlike the earlier enactments, as pointed out by my previous speakers, there is no time limit. So it went on. And in one of the cases it was found, India takes roughly about 4.3 years to take up a proceedings. And you know about the company proceedings which are pending in the courts, it takes more time. Therefore, it was thought fit that several lakhs of rupees were also locked up in the litigation. Therefore, the government of India has thought it fit as to whether prescription of a time limit would serve the purpose and whether it is possible to have a resolution within such time. Accordingly, after a study, Government of India, the act has been enacted with a specific time-bound resolution of 180 days, which may be extended for a further period of 90 days. Now we have trees. I was talking about the new concepts and institutions introduced by the court. One is called as a corporate debtor. Debt is defined as financial debt and operational debt. I don't go on to the details of that because I have read the provisions, but anyway, the speakers will explain to you, the resource persons will explain to us to what is the difference between a corporate creditor, debtor, a corporate creditor, an operational creditor, an operational debtor, etc., etc. Debt, financial operation, creditor, financial and operational, insolvency, professional, committee of creditors. This is a very new concept, in fact, has been introduced in the court, and the role of the committee of creditors has also been explained, and how they would facilitate the insolvent, the IPR, to arrive at a conclusion as to whether this plan, that is insolvency plan which is furnished, would serve the purpose. All those things are very much available in the court. And finally, we have, in respect of individuals, what is called as a fresh start process, and for the firms, adjudicating authority, etc., are also specified. This is a court, in order to achieve resolution of distress, has also specified certain measures to be taken up under Section 7, 8, 9 and 10. And I will only briefly read for the purpose of the lawyers and for myself also, because I have not been dealing with these matters excepting for 3 months when I sat on the company's side. And now sitting on a bench relating to challenge to the notification enactments, we have an occasion to consider as to the virus of certain enactments. But this particular enactment has provided 3 sets of persons to approach the company law tribunal. One is a financial creditor. Financial creditors are those who extend financial debt to a corporate debtor or to whom financial debt is assigned by a financial creditor. In case of financial creditor, the moment the financial default occurs, he can take up an application under Section 7 to the NCLT for initiating the insolvency resolution process. Then we have an operational creditor. Briefly stating, these creditors are to whom corporate debtor owns operational debt. There is a difference between a financial debt, because a financial debt normally involves money. But here it is money on goods and services, employment or dues to any government under law, or to whom such debt is assigned by an operational creditor. So here again, an operational creditor who is different from a financial creditor can move an application. Then here we call as a corporate applicant. This corporate applicant includes the corporate debtor or a shareholder, management personnel or employees satisfying certain criteria. So as pointed out, an employee can also move an application before the company law board. There are few provisions which I would like to read out. Sections 4 to 32 are the provisions which deal with substantive as well as procedural aspects of initiating a corporate insolvency resolution process. It also contains a period moratorium during which no action can be taken against a company. The constitution of company of creditors and appointment of insolvency professionals. Sections 33 to 54 deal with substantive as well as procedural aspects of liquidating of a company corporate debtor, including the process of consolidation, verification and admission rejection of claims, manner of determination and treatment of preferential and undervalued transactions, and such other things. Section 60 to 77 deal with offences, appeals, offences, penalties, etc. So there are other enactments, other sections also. It's a comprehensive code, just like we have the Motor Vehicles Act. Every person's duty and functions are explained. An insolvency resolution person is explained. The power of the committee of creditors is explained. The power of the adjudicator is explained. Assistance from how it can be obtained, data from where it can be collected. So it's a very comprehensive code. It deals with every aspect of a resolution of the insolvency. As I find from going through, because yesterday only I read the entire provisions, it took about nearly 2 p.m. to go through the entire, 2 a.m. I should say, the early morning, go through the entire provisions. There's a code provides for a comprehensive mechanism by involving all the stakeholders. As pointed out, I think they are not always said, okay, and some of you may understand Tamil, Mr. Justice Mahapathyam, Judge of the Supreme Court, I don't know whether he has learned Tamil in Chennai. Little bit, konja konjam. So we call it insolvent. Manjat Kadidasi means it's a letter saying that he has become insolvent. So we always treat him as an insolvent, as a person in fact who doesn't have any rights, voting rights, etc., etc. But then the character has slightly changed, because during the process of the insolvency resolution, there is always a chance for this particular company to get it revived. Never it was the intention of the legislature so far, though it is there in the Security Session Act, as I pointed out, to restructure, make it revive, and then make it as an ongoing company. But this process, certainly has, would have helped the realization of the money as well as restructuring of the companies as well. But Mr. Om Prakash was reading the message of Honorable Justice Kaul, Judge Supreme Court of India. From the above, I could find the successful implementation of this particular code and how I think it has brought back several thousands and lakhs of money locked up to help the creditors. I will only read once again the message of Honorable Justice Kaul. A testament to the appropriate intervention and effective implementation of the code is the official figures which indicate that as of March 2019, 4,452 cases were disposed of at the pre-admission stage. You can refer to Section 7 or Section 14 also as to how I think the cases are being disposed of at the pre-admission stage before the tribunals. And the amount is really staggering. At the admission stage, settling an amount of around 2.02 lakh crores, a very huge amount, while 66 cases were resolved. But I could only find that, I do not know, out of the 452 cases filed, 66 cases alone have resolved. This area certainly requires to be addressed, because why not? I think many of the cases have not been resolved. What is the difficulty in resolving in that particular? See, the resolution process sets out a time limit. The filing of the cases, in fact, it is not mentioned. The number of cases which are filed before the courts. But then, 4,452 cases have been disposed of at the pre-admission stage, settling an amount of 2.02 crores. This will only indicate that either the the corporate debtor doesn't want to go after the stage of the admission. Because once it is admitted, the insolvency, the process, I think the entire management, he loses control, and then the IPR steps in. And therefore, probably I think before it is being admitted, they come forward to settle the entire amount, negotiate and settle. But the question now to be addressed according to me is that why only 66 cases have been resolved? Why not more cases? 260 cases were ordered for liquidation. In the 66 cases resolved, creditors were able to realize a sum of rupees 80,000 crores. His Lordship has also said about 70,000 crores are expected from the adjudication of pending cases in the year 2019 alone. Before parting, in fact, I should thank Mr. Om Prakash, Senior Advocate, Mr. Vijay Narayanan, probably who has suggested my name, I think, to be there in this particular August body, for giving me this opportunity. And I wish the Bar Council of Tamil Nadu and Puducherry take up many more seminars on various subjects which would help the fraternity. And taking cue from this, though in fact we do not have this particular jurisdiction vest with the district judges or others, but then I would take up this matter with the academy and conduct a seminar or a program for our lawyers who have completed about 10 years and above, so that I think when they aspire for some post like this, say for instance a member of the tribunal, they will be better equipped. And I may require some of the members here to address the academy on the subject. And there are certain cases also which I have read yesterday night, so that I think there are two judgments of Justice Mohapatra as a chairman of the appellate tribunal. Some of the decisions which I think notable, you can take it on. Absol, Swiss Rebonds, Vijay Kumar Jain, Tata Steel, Sashidhar, that's decided by Justice Mohapatra. So I have some more line of some decisions also. If you read these decisions, I think about 6 or 7 decisions of the Supreme Court and some of the decisions of the appellate tribunal, I think the whole gamut of this particular law, the code, you can understand. And that would be beneficial for the lawyers, in fact, to address the difference, in fact, what is how the judges of the Supreme Court has dealt with the matter. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you very much, Honorable Justice S. Manikumarji. That was some serious insight into the enactment, and the last suggestion is very welcoming for us lawyers. Thank you so much, sir.